WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
From 10 to 12, here on 1010 WOLB, is the Frank M. Conaway Sr. and our show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith-Wilson.
Good morning once again, Baltimore and beyond. I hope you had a great week, and I hope this is a great start to your weekend, especially your long weekend. I am an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. Part of the services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you have the need to buy or sell your property or to purchase your ground rent or to update your will or deed, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. And for the listeners who want to comment or have a question, feel free to text it to us if you're not able to get through on the telephone lines at 667-334-7242. And if you miss a broadcast, feel free to go online to YouTube and type in Frank Conaway Senior Show, and you'll be able to listen to all of our past broadcasts on your phone, on your television, on your computer. So go check us out and spread the word.
All righty. See, that's what you get when you got somebody young, got IT experience. Amen. And our other co-host, attorney Robert Bob, I call him the Dean Dashiell.
Good morning, Baltimore. I'm happy to be with you on this Memorial Day weekend. And I want to say that for me, this Memorial Day is one that I'm really thinking about my father, who was 48 years old when he was killed some years ago. I was 17 at the time. So, but I remember him this day and all others who I loved and who've passed on over time, as I'm sure the rest of you do as well, the rest of our listeners do. So 410-547-8820 is my number if you have issues relating to contracting with the local, state, or federal government.
And yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas, of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number is 410-669-1738. Specializing in at-need, pre-need, pre-arrangements, seminars, veteran benefits, veterans, please get your DD-214. And you know the drill. Everybody ought to get some insurance or increase what you got. You heard right after our theme song, one of the, well, let me put it like this. We have lost two legends this week and within the last week. One in the person of Jim Brown, who some will say possibly was the greatest running back ever in football. And then the other day, we lost the icon of rock and roll, Sister Annie Mae Bullock.
Otherwise known as?
Tina Turner.
Right.
two greats have gone on. Now, Bob, I tell these young boys, I'm talking about Jim now. Because Jim Brown is even before Tehma's time. Because he retired at 65.
Right.
He only played 9 seasons. But I tell all these young boys out here playing football now, go back and look at a clip of Jim Brown. Because not only, Jim Brown just ran over you.
Well, you know, Sam Huff said, Sam, it was a great middle linebacker if you, for Giants, I think it was. But Sam Huff said, all you could do is grab him and wait for help.
Yep.
Yep. That's all you could do is grab him and wait for help.
Because he go across the line with 2 or 3 hanging on to him.
But the most notable thing, at least, is more. Also, he was a great lacrosse player, too.
He's
in the Hall of Fame for lacrosse.
Yeah, he's one of the greatest lacrosse players ever been.
But one of the things that was most notable is what he said to Art Modell, you know, when Jim Brown was off pursuing his filming career, his movie career, Modell proposed to fine him. Mm-hmm. For not showing up for camp.
Mm-hmm.
So Jim called a press conference and quit. Mm-hmm. He was only 30 years old when he retired.
Yeah, he was.
I mean, he quit because he told Modell, you don't own me.
Right.
And quit. They just walked away from the game entirely. And he was, you know, one of the great organizers of athletes and other entertainers that supported the movement for equality among black folk. Yeah. And I think that his model, his example, if the modern day black athlete follows Jim Brown's example, if more of them did, we'd be a lot better off than we are now.
Yeah, we'll talk a little more about him a little later.
Right.
Along with Tina Turner, who, if anybody knows about her story, is a fantastic story in itself. Going back to when she was like, I remember going down Cars Beach.
Oh, yeah.
Down in Annapolis, seeing Ike and Tina Turner review, or they come to the Raw.
Right,
you know?
Right.
And she went through a lot of hardships.
Well, he was a monster.
I mean, he was.
He was an absolute monster.
Yeah, he was. Absolute.
And especially for Tina Turner to be in the genre of rock and roll.
Right.
I mean, since her, I can't think of any other African-American, male or female,
that's
been a worldwide superstar in the arena of rock and roll.
Yep.
So that was a great feat.
Yeah. Yep.
Right.
Yep. Okay. We have a special guest on the line. I'm going to let Sister Tehma introduce our special. Yeah, let's see. Wait a minute.
Good morning, Baltimore, once again. This is our last week in May, and we would like to take another opportunity to focus on our women. And even though you may not be a woman, you may know one, love one, or care for one. So this week we are going to focus on maternal mortality. This topic has been in the news lately, especially around Mother's Day when the CDC released a report which updated the U.S. on the latest statistics when it comes to maternal mortality. So today in our News You Can Use or Information for Dissemination segment, we have with us Dr. Analeta Peterson, who is an African-American OBGYN. She is a board-certified obstetrician and gynecologist practicing in the Baltimore area. Dr. Peterson graduated from Florida A&M University with a degree in biology. Congratulations, HBCUs. She received her medical degree from Meharry Medical College in Nashville, Tennessee. She has now been delivering babies and serving women in the state of Maryland for the last 9 years. Good morning, Dr. Analeta. How are you doing today?
Good morning, Tehma. How are you? Glad to be here today.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for joining us. Can you give us a general definition on what maternal mortality is?
Yes, I can. But before we kind of get into that definition, I just want to kind of remind everybody about, you know, what kind of brought our attention, the medical field, what brought our attention to this whole thing about maternal mortality, because it's recently kind of just been in the year, in the news, I'm sorry, for the last few years. So one of the cases that kind of helped the medical community wake up is the story of Kira Johnson. So, and Kira died in the year of 2016. So she is, or she was, a 39-year-old Black female. She went into the hospital for a scheduled cesarean delivery in the state of California. And after her delivery, everything went well with the C-section at the time. But after the delivery, her husband noticed there was some blood in her catheter bag. So he states that he brought this to the attention of the medical staff at the time, but there were delays in directly addressing the issue. So after a few hours, Kira was taken back to the operating room, and they discovered that she had been bleeding internally, I guess, for several hours at that point. And Kira actually died that day, just several hours after giving birth. So since 2016, her husband has basically become an activist. He has traveled all across the United States telling her story. He's actually presented at some of the medical conferences that I've attended. And so this story, at least for me, kind of sounded the alarm and made us as a medical community aware of this disparity, and has kind of brought to light many women who have died in a similar way that Kira has died. And so to kind of, go ahead.
No, go ahead, finish.
So I was just going to say, to give you that definition, how do we define maternal mortality? So it's defined as the death of a woman while pregnant or within 42 days of the end of pregnancy. So if you look at that 42 days, that's basically 6 weeks after delivery. So that's a lot of the time women will go back to work or resume their normal activities within 6 weeks after delivery. And then pregnancy, so we're not just talking about full-term delivery. So this could be a woman who dies at the time and she's having a miscarriage, or a woman who may have an ectopic pregnancy, or even a preterm delivery. So any type of pregnancy where a woman dies is kind of included in this maternal mortality rate.
Okay, and I know it was in the news because this is prevalent in the USA, and is highly prevalent in the USA compared to other countries throughout the world. Do you have any statistics for that?
Yeah, so that's kind of the other thing that has kind of piqued our interest here in the United States and has led to a lot of legislation being created. So there was one study that's been published as recently as 2020. So they looked at some data from 2018 and a little bit prior to that. So at that time, in 2018, there were about 17 maternal deaths for every 100,000 live births. And so that's actually, at the time, that was double the number of deaths of other high-income countries. So if we compare at that time, if we compare countries like the Netherlands or Norway or New Zealand, they were only having about three deaths per 100,000 women. Looking at countries such as the UK or Canada, they have between 6 to 9 deaths per 100,000 live births. So for the U.S. to have 17, more recently, we're at 32.9 per 100,000 live births. So it's really it really is a big difference when we compare ourselves to these other countries.
Can that data be disaggregated based upon income? In other words, if you look at I think the question, you understand the question. Can it be disaggregated based on income?
Income of, you of, mean the, by of the mother, or
of the, no, 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 of the mother, of the mother. I mean, among the, you know, the mothers earning, or in families that earn under a certain amount of dollars, is maternal death more prevalent than those from families earning in, over that amount?
So, I don't have that data for when we compare, you know, the United States with other countries. But when we look within the United States, as far as it goes with Black women, when we look at Black women who earn a certain amount of money, and we compare that to white women who earn.
Yeah, no. I don't want a racial comparison. I want it strictly on the basis of dollars.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have that data?
No, I don't have that data. No.
Okay.
Right. Yeah.
Okay, well, when it comes to African Americans, how do we rate in terms of our mortality, maternal mortality rates against other demographics? Is it more prevalent? Is it less prevalent?
Right. So it is, unfortunately, more prevalent in the Black community. When we look at the data from 2021, the mortality rate of Black women was 2.6 times the rate for non-Hispanic white women. So that means for every white woman who may have died in pregnancy or after delivery, 2.6 Black women would have died during their pregnancy.
And is there like a particular age range that most of the women who suffer from this die? Is it usually younger women or middle-aged women or older women on the, you know, pregnancy side?
Right. So this actually does increase after age 35. So age 35 is kind of considered to be a high-risk pregnancy in general. But when we look at mortality, we do see that we're having more women die after age 35. And then it increases significantly for women who are giving birth in their 40s.
Okay. And when we look at the African-American community, I know a lot of times the question is it based on our race in terms of the makeup of the African-American women that gives us a higher mortality, maternal mortality rate, or is it based on racism in terms of African-American women not getting the same care or amount of treatment that other women get?
Right. So, and a lot of studies have kind of looked at that because we're trying to, you know, really figure out what's going on here, especially with the disparity between Black women and white women. But most of the studies are showing that it is because of racism. In other words, we're showing that Black women are not receiving the same treatment or level of care as other races, which is driving this disparity in maternal mortality. So like I was kind of stating earlier, when we look at the socioeconomic status of Black women, it doesn't seem to make a difference. So a Black woman will have insurance. She will have access to care. She can even be very well educated. When we compare those women to white women who have a very similar background, we're still seeing that Black women die at a higher rate.
Well, when you say they have a very similar background, are you saying that the data is available, the income and the per capita income of the family, that data is available? Let me tell you the hypothetical. I'm supposing that family income of 100,000, white or black, would have nearly the equivalent number the same amount of mortality, of maternity, and it's not really about race. It's more about income than race.
I think. Yeah.
Is that? Would you? What's your response to that proposition, if you will?
So the studies have looked exactly at that question, and it's not true. So a Black woman and a white woman can have the exact same income, and Black women die at a higher rate despite having the same income, the same education level, the same access to care.
And I think that was noted in the news when Serena Williams had her first child. Mm. And after her pregnancy, she was experiencing difficulties like clots in her lungs or whatever. And they would not give her the proper treatment that she needed. Like they would say, oh, well, it's not that bad, or we don't understand what's going on. And she almost died because after she delivered a baby, she wasn't given the proper treatment as someone else who might have said, oh, my chest hurt. And then they would have done 50 million types of exams to see why her chest hurt. So I could understand that regardless of how much money you have as an African-American, that doesn't necessarily give you better care, you know, when they look at your circumstances when you're in the hospital. Is that what you're trying to say, Doc?
Right, that's exactly correct. In other cases that were not as high profile as Serena, but there was a doctor who worked at the CDC. She recently died. And there was a medical physician who died from high blood pressure in pregnancy. So these are both Black women who are high earners, and they, they're still dying at higher rates than white women.
Is there a type of lifestyle that African-American women can live, or certain type of do's or don'ts that you shouldn't do when you're pregnant to help kind of decrease your chances of maternal mortality?
Other than smoking and drinking, you mean?
Right. Exactly. Other than the things we might know of, are there any other things that, you know, will help deter that?
So that's a good question. And the answer is not really. So like you guys, you know, stated, the things that we shouldn't do are some of those general things that most people know, smoking, drinking, and drugs. Those are things you want to stay away from.
Yeah.
But what we have found is that the majority of cases of maternal death in pregnancy are related to cardiovascular disease. And so these are things like high blood pressure, stroke, heart failure, blood clots. And so besides, you know, taking your medication that the doctor has prescribed you, besides not smoking, you know, there's really not a whole lot you can do to decrease this risk as far as those basic things.
Well, let me ask this question. Does the data exist that distinguishes the care and level of treatment provided by African-American healthcare providers, doctors, versus those women who are being treated by non-African Americans? The proposition being can we expect the same kind of care? My suspicion is that the women who are treated by African American doctors are more likely to receive this kind of care that they really need versus others who are not in the same community. Is there data that relates to that issue?
Yes, I actually read an article that said that African American women have a better chance of not being a victim of maternal mortality if they are treated by African American OBGYNs.
That's what I suspect.
Yeah, I had heard that too.
Right, and so my question would be: as an African American female, how do you, since the lifestyle, you know, we know what to do. A lot of people try to avoid that. How do African Americans advocate for themselves when they are pregnant or after they're pregnant if they're having any type of issues, where people in the medical profession will take them seriously and give them the type of help that they need? How do we advocate? What is the best way for that?
Honestly, you know, as the saying goes, the squeaky wheel gets the oil. And so just being very, very persistent in your complaints to your doctor. So just being willing or being... just being able to say to your doctor, I do not feel comfortable with this, you know, and just saying that until you get the treatment that you feel like you deserve. Another nice thing about pregnancy is that you can walk into any hospital at any time of the day with any complaint. And some patients will do this. If they are seen at one hospital in Baltimore and they don't like the answer that they receive, you can quickly go to a different hospital in the state of in the city and maybe be reevaluated by a different medical team. So just being persistent, if you really feel like, you know, you're not being treated well, you're not getting the care that you deserve, or your concerns are being ignored, you know, either make that very clear to the medical team and let them know, like, you know, you're not comfortable, or go to another hospital and be seen.
Are you aware of any advocacy position being promoted in advocacy for treatment by African-American OBGYN doctors? Since we know that we can expect better care there, is there an organization that you know of that promotes or advocates for black women to actually increase the capacity of African-American doctors to care for more African-American women?
Yeah, so there's one organization that has been pretty, vocal, and that's the Black Mamas Matter movement. So they have a website, and you can go to their website to see all that they're promoting and recommending. And there are, just kind of within the community of Black OBGYNs, we kind of know one another. We kind of know where to direct people. So just kind of just reaching out to us. A lot of us are on social media. So just reaching out to us and asking questions, and we're happy to help as much as we can. Okay.
One statistic that you threw out there, when I often think of maternal mortality, I think of, you know, death at the time of birth. But you say it can take place up to 42 weeks after delivery. Does postpartum play any way into maternal mortality?
Yes. So actually, especially in the state of Maryland, more women are actually dying in that postpartum period than they are during the pregnancy. So that is why now we are having more visits during the postpartum period. We're asking patients to be seen at least twice. During that time, more often if you have high blood pressure. I think a few states have even expanded like Medicaid coverage. So it used to would only cover, you know, 6 weeks after delivery, and now it's been extended in some states. So we are, you know, doing a little bit better of a job of taking care of women in that postpartum period, because that is when we are seeing more deaths occur.
I think that's a great thing, because usually when a mother has a kid, once she delivers the baby, when she goes back to the doctors, with any frequency, it's for the baby, right? And not necessarily for herself and for her care. So I'm glad that they are expanding that window. And I know you're part of an organization called Embrace Grace. Can you give us more information about that organization?
Sure. So Embrace Grace is basically a support group and also Bible study for unwed mothers. We take women really of any age, but anywhere from, you know, teenagers up to women in their 30s and 40s.
And does it have to be your first child, or do you have to be at a certain stage in your pregnancy in order to be a part of this focus group or encouragement group?
No. So you can be your third pregnancy, your first pregnancy. It really doesn't matter. I'm sorry, what was the other question? What stage of the pregnancy?
Right.
Right. So it can be at the very beginning of pregnancy, or you could have already delivered, and we are still here to support you and to kind of help encourage you as you walk through your pregnancy.
How many times a year do you have sessions as a part of this organization?
So we have about 2 sessions per year. We begin in April, so we're in the middle of a session currently. And then we'll have our next session will begin in September. And both of the sessions are about 12 weeks in length.
Thank you very much. Is there one particular advice or something that we should know to take away when it comes to the topic of maternal mortality?
Yeah, so, you know, other than being an advocate, that's actually probably the strongest piece of advice that I can give you. Just be persistent. Just know that if you keep bringing up your concerns, that they will eventually be heard. But then also optimizing your health before pregnancy. So if you are considering pregnancy, especially if you're in your 30s, you know, see your primary care doctor first. Make sure that, you know, your health, you are in good health before you get pregnant, especially if you know that things like high blood pressure or heart conditions or even preeclampsia, if you know these things run in your family, you want to make sure that you are in good health before you get pregnant so that you can have an easier pregnancy course.
Any other questions from anybody?
No, I'm good.
Doctor, I just have one question. And maybe it might be too soon to answer, and it's not concerning the mortality rate, but it's concerning something that is in your field, because you are OBGYN, correct?
I am.
Okay. I don't know if you talk to some of your other professionals in the field across the state, but you know what's going on with the reversal of Roe versus Wade, in which the red states now are, you know, coming up with so many stringent abortion laws that if a young lady needs an abortion, she may have to come to a state like Maryland or others that have more lenient abortion laws. Have you heard from any of your constituents that they're seeing more people come to this state from other states just to get an abortion?
To be honest with you, I have not. Not in the state of Maryland. I have read, you know, stories about doctors in other states who've had this issue.
Mm-hmm.
But I have not. I've not heard of anyone in this state. That issue.
Well, we certainly thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to be with the Frank M. Conaway Senior et al. Show with co-host Attorney Tehma Smith Wilson, Attorney Robert Bob DeShields, and myself, Carlton Douglas. Anytime that you have any medical information that you think needs to get out to our public, you have an open door to get in touch with Tehma, and we get you on.
And do you have any contact information, like an email or something that you would like to leave?
So for, I would say, for the Embrace Grace organization, if anyone is interested in that program, you can go to embracegrace.com and look for the groups that are located in Baltimore. And my email address, I believe, is on that website. And then for women who are looking for prenatal care or just women's health care, you can actually find me on Instagram under Dr. Analeta. That's Dranaleta.
Thank you once again, Doc. It was a pleasure having you here.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you, Doc.
Thank you, guys.
All right.
Have a nice day.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, you as well.
All right. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. That means if you can't hear us too well on the radio, you could get us on the internet, or you could download the TuneIn app and put in 1010 OLB. Got a couple lines open, 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. When we come to the phones, we're coming to Leo, Carlos, and Sandra. And like I said, we got a couple lines open. We mentioned about losing Jim Brown, but we also lost Tina Turner. Now, I know it's a little young for you, Tehma, but what do you remember about Tina Turner in your lifetime?
Not too young, but I... definitely remember the movie. I think that opened a lot of people's eyes.
What love got to do with it?
Right.
Yeah.
To her progression through life, how she came to be where she is. Because a lot of times, especially with superstars, back in the day before they had Instagram and Facebook, and superstars were putting everything up online so you know what they're doing day to day. You know, you really had no idea what some of our celebrities might have been going through in their personal life or in their day-to-day struggles. So I think that movie gave us an insight into her life and gave us more respect for who she was and what she'd been through and, you know, how she got to where she was able to get to. And I was fortunate to be able to see her perform in Philadelphia not too long ago. I think it might have been no more than 10 years ago.
Okay.
So if she passed away at 83, she had to be in her 70s.
73 then.
And she was still top notch, performing, dancing, singing, flying in the air, doing all of the above, you know, all through her touring, no matter how old she was or what stage of life she was in. So she was definitely a high performing and an excellent performer.
Yeah.
And I think she has a lasting impact because, like I said, I haven't seen anyone come behind her as of yet.
Yeah, she was phenomenal. Bob, what was your thoughts about her?
What's love got to do with a secondhand emotion? That's my thought.
And she, I'm telling you, she came up with some great hits. And the thing was, when she left Ike with 36 cents. That's all she had.
And a name.
And a name. And she went to court and won the name because she had to go to court to get that, keep that name. So two great legends gone, Tina Turner and the one and only Jim Brown, okay? All right, like I said, we got a couple lines open, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. Let's go to Leo. Leo, you on air?
Yes, good morning, my friends. How are you?
Fine.
Okay. I want to start with an announcement. The Roots of Scouting Incorporated 501c3 organization is holding its annual Jazz in the Sanctuary concert at St. James Episcopal Church the day before Father's Day, Saturday, June the 17th, from 12 noon to 3 o'clock. We're featuring a quartet headed up by the renowned gospel keyboardist Patrick Alston. And, of course, there is, for the $40 ticket price, of course, there's a hot lunch included. So we say come one, come all, in fellowship and in honor of Father's Day, come out and join us. Phone numbers to call for specific additional information, 443-651-2578, 443-651-2578, or 443-492-8543.
Now, 443. I was there last year, Leo. I kept trying to get Leo to tell us who the artist was last year, and he kept filibustering on telling us who the artist was going to be. And I went and winded up, it was a young man I called my nephew, Patrick Austin, who is a renowned, phenomenal keyboard artist. I mean, he plays everything from the electric piano to a pipe organ. That's right. In fact, he did some jazz on the pipe last year at Leo's and them concert. So they're moving to St. James this year, which is a historical black Episcopal church here in the city, has produced two bishops in the Episcopal church, one being the head now, Bishop Carey. So it should be quite interesting, Leo.
Amen. 829 North Arlington Avenue at Lafayette. Lafayette Arlington Avenue is the location at the square. St. James Episcopal. Also, I'm speaking now as an individual regarding the debt ceiling. And I'm sure all of you have some concerns, or maybe nothing negative will happen, but it seems to be brinksmanship 101 with regard to this debt ceiling. Maybe this should have been addressed 6 months or a year ago. I don't know. But I do know that if my Social Security check is stopped, it may be a death sentence. If you cut it or stop it, it's a death sentence. And my individual response as a community organizer, agitator, activist, is that there has to be or will be, we must make sure there will be massive civil disobedience as a result. We have to utilize tactics and strategies, preferably nonviolent, but tactics and strategies that speak to grinding this country to a halt. And I'm targeting public transportation, Amtrak, airports, bridges, whatever. Slow it down. Carry your blankets, your non-perishable foods in your cars, because nobody's going anywhere. Whether it's Woodrow Wilson Bridge, 14th Street Bridge, and we can go on. So I want other people to chime in, give their thoughts, and thank you all for what you do for our community. Your activism and this program is certainly renowned for its doing what we need to have done. We need to have the conversation that speaks to intelligent solutions to problems. We don't always agree, but we should be at least listening to each other's ideas and strategies. Thank you all.
Leo, want to give that date again and the time and the place?
For the Jazz in the Sanctuary,
yeah.
It's Saturday, June the 17th, day before Father's Day. Saturday, June 17th.
What time?
12 noon.
Okay.
From 12 noon to 3 o'clock in the afternoon. We have an hour of jazz, then we have 45 minutes for lunch, then we have another hour or so for jazz. Okay. St. James Episcopal Church, Arlington Avenue at Lafayette, 829 North Arlington Avenue. Interested in tickets or more information, those phone numbers I gave out, 443-651-2578. We need to have these tickets paid for, preferably no later than the 12th. No later than the 12th of June, so that we can purchase the food in the amount of those who are, we're sure, who will be in attendance.
All right.
God bless you.
Okay, I'm going to get two from you, Leo, because I enjoyed it last year. I'm going to try to go if I'm in town. Let's go to Brother Carlos. You on there.
Good morning, and thank you for taking my call. Listen, this is just additional information on the important guest that you just had on maternity health. There is a book called Medical Apartheid put out by a writer by the name of Harriet Washington. She's a medical specialist and ethicist. And what she says basically is that just in the treatment of physical health for African Americans, we have the same disparities in the maternal health and other aspects of our health life for African Americans. And apparently it is based on inherent discrimination. And there's a term she has developed called dimorphism, D-I-M-O-R-P-H-I-S-M, that describes this particular phenomenon. So if you can't get the book, you can Google her name, Harriet Washington, Medical Apartheid, you know, for further information. A lot of that stuff is going to be exacerbated exponentially because of what the red states are doing and how they are approaching the abortion weeks and the medical care. And I think we're going to have a situation where the women are going to be treated just like Red Scott across the nation, three-fifths of a human being in this particular medical abortion field. And finally, on Tina Turner, she died from kidney failure, basically, because she failed to take her high blood medication as it was prescribed.
Yep.
She relied on holistic health advice, and she acknowledged that months before she died. And I think we should take that heed from her. Stay on top of our medication, blood pressure medication, and follow up with your physicians. And by the way, Carlton, one of your past friends, David Rice, who passed away recently, did pretty much the same thing, from my personal knowledge.
Yeah.
So we gotta be woke on that issue.
Yeah. And just for clarification, she died from intestinal cancer as well as stroke and kidney failure.
Yeah.
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 Yes, sir.
I saw that same article that Carlos saw the other day where she admits that she let her health get that bad because she wasn't doing what she was supposed to have done with the ailment she knew she had, like hypertension. And hypertension is a sure enough way you're going to get kidney failure.
And especially, and she had already been a kidney recipient.
Yeah.
Her husband,
yeah,
Edward,
had
her one of his kidneys.
Right, right.
Yeah. You know, now, in the positive light, I'll get out here with this, is she managed to settle her estate well before her death, got all the paperwork, everything out of the way as to how her assets were going to be divided, so that there's not going to be any family fighting or contention and so forth over her $277 million estate. Yeah. And so what you have pointed to, Carlton, is get your affairs in order and so forth before time. It's what she followed, and we have to thank her for that as well as
I wouldn't be so quick to conclude that. This she's not here to oversee her plan, so it's yet to be seen whether or not there'll be any fights among the kids, those that she adopted as well as her own.
Well, anyway. the interesting thing about it, we may never know because she died in Switzerland, so they may never unseal that or what get the story out.
Yeah, it depends on where the assets are located. Yeah.
Let's put it that way. She at least went through the
That's right. She did the best she could.
Paperwork, procedures, and what else comes after that. But of course, two of her sons have already passed away.
Yeah, two of them have.
So,
yeah.
I mean, I think she only had three, didn't she?
Yeah, but she adopted two of Ike's.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, gotcha. Gotcha. Okay. All right, well,
thank you for taking my call
and valuable information. Thank you.
Okay.
One thing that came up in the news that I was interested mm-hmm. to ask a Floridian at heart about is, how do you feel about the NCAA travel advisory against the state of Florida? Is that going to stop you from going down there? Do you feel that it's truly
mean the NAACP?
NAACP.
Oh, okay.
Do you feel that it's truly open and hostile towards African Americans? Is that going to stop any of your traveling plans or spending your money in Florida? How do you feel about that ban?
You ask Carlos a minute. Hey, yeah.
I'm asking anyone who wants
to. Oh, well, I can tell you now, I ain't going to Florida. As long as DeSantis down there, I'm not going. I'm not spending a dime down there for him at all.
All right.
But that's just me.
I understood.
That was, I had that same position, but I'm not going to take the bait of labeling Florida as DeSantis, as a DeSantis possession. I've come to rethink it. I have a number of friends that are there that I'm going to visit from time to time. I may even go back to play golf. I'm not going to concede that Florida belongs to DeSantis, and I'm hopeful that at some point the majority of people there who vote will agree with me. But who knows?
Sandra, you on air?
Yes, good morning. I have one thing that I differ with the doctor when she said,
turn your radio down, Sandra.
Okay, change your hospital. I disagree with her on that. If you go to a hospital and you're not getting the proper service that you think that you should have, you should change your doctor, but not change your hospital.
No, she didn't say that. Right. She did not advocate changing your hospital. She said if you wanted to. That in some cases people had gone from one to another, but she was not advocating that as a practice.
Right. She was saying that if you are not feeling well and say you go to Johns Hopkins, they don't give you the proper treatment or advice that you think you need and you still don't feel well, maybe you need to leave Johns Hopkins and go to another emergency room.
Let me tell you what I did. That I worked at Sinai for 18 years. I was a nurse in Sinai, 18 years. I had my doctor there. And one morning, I had an appointment at 10 before I go on the floor. So when I went to his office, they got me ready, and I was put in the room till he came. So I waited, and I waited, and I waited. And I said, what's taking him so long? I just happened to get up and walk back towards his office. And he was sitting back there reading a sports magazine. Now, you know what I did? I did not complain to him. I went to the supervisor of the whole hospital, and I said, I do not want that doctor. He's not concerned with my health. He's concerned about the illustration of the magazine.
Mm-hmm.
I said, I don't want him. So any facility that I deal with,
mm-hmm.
if I don't get the service that I want, I go to the next level. And let me tell you something. I worked at Sinai. When I first started, my vacation time came up. So I put in for my vacation. My supervisor came to me and said, oh, no. We're sure to help. You can't have your vacation there.
Now, does this have to do with maternal health? Wait a minute. Hold on. Does this have to do with maternal health? Because I really don't want to have time to listen to your employment history.
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm saying that if you don't get the service that you want or you think you should need, you should go to another level.
Okay.
And as far as black maternity health, you ask the question. The reason why some blacks don't get the proper health care that they need is because they don't have the proper insurance.
Thank you, Sandra. Let's go to Gene. Gene, you're on air.
Yeah, happy Friday, guys. Just like make an announcement, if I may.
Mm-hmm.
Will Hanna is throwing his hat in the ring, and he's running for up here where I live in Park Heights. He's running for city council position. So I just wanted to announce that. He announced that on the Morgan station.
Okay, now is he running as a what?
Oh, I have no idea, man. It's like Will probably will come on and, outline his platform. But because I live here, you know, it's important to me personally, so I don't want to, you know, try to be an expert or something that I'm not in reference to.
And
to him, I have my opinions.
Who's your current city council person?
Oh, Izzy, I live in Upper Parkway, so it's Izzy Slifer.
Okay.
All okay, right. So why is it called? 14th Amendment. Piggybacking on Leo as a senior, you know, I'm concerned about my Social Security and what the Republicans can and cannot do. I just want to mention to people: read the 14th Amendment, the Section 4. Bob, help me out. Section 4 of the 14th Amendment addresses, you know, what's going to be paid and what's not going to be paid. It's not clear, but the Republicans are using their interpretation of it. And for me, and what I see is, and I've been sort of, you know, watching it, they're flying under the radar. And my son brought this to my attention. He used to work at a sporting goods store, and he worked around a lot of Yahoos who were purchasing, you know, the semi-automatic weapons of mass destruction, and they were discussing, and this is like 5 years ago, they were discussing the strategy of really undermining the 14th Amendment, and that to me is, you know, what we should be educating ourselves about, and also learning to interpret the Constitution and not let other people interpret it for us. And we can see how Trump, In a sense, his court, and what's the brother's name who's the head, whose court it is right now? Because I don't like mentioning his name.
Roberts.
But anyway, who's that?
It's really Clarence Thomas's court, but they still say it's Roberts' court.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Thank you for, you said it, and I'm not going to ever say it. But anyway, so that, you know, that's the direction that the Republicans are moving, is literally to undermine the 14th Amendment, and I think we should be, you know,
let me respond. Number one, the U.S. is not going to default on this debt. That's number one.
Yes.
Because there's money always coming in. June 15th is the big pay date for corporate. So they're going to pay the interest on the debt. The government is not going to, your Social Security is not going to stop or any of those things. The government, even without the issue on the Section 4 of the 14th Amendment, is whether the president has the right to declare raising the debt ceiling without congressional approval. That's the constitutional issue. But putting that aside, the government is going to pay its interest on its bonds. The government is going to pay its bills, and that will continue for months beyond the so-called June deadline. The issue is not about the debt. The issue is about who has the power to control the direction of the country politically. Marjorie Greene and Laurent Bobbitt or Joe Biden.
And I don't really focus too much on the debt ceiling, because I know even if things don't work out, I have maybe a little bit to lose. But the power that bees have a lot to lose.
Yep.
And so they're definitely not going to let that happen.
Yep. Yeah. Kevin, you on air. Kevin? Kevin once? Kevin twice?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you now.
Yeah.
Okay. Here's the biggest thing that came down from the Supreme Court. I want every black person to remember this and go get the money. My aunt lost her property in D.C. Okay. They said that she owed taxes. I forgot where she was at. Maybe Martha's Vineyard or whatever. They sold the property more than what the tax debt was owed for. Okay. The Supreme Court has now said that if you had a water bill, anything, that if it was $2,000 and the city sold your property for $10,000, they got to give you back that money.
That's never been a question. Why you say that's a new decision? That's always been the law.
I don't know.
No, it's not been the law.
So.
No. The Supreme Court came down with the decision saying that the city would have to cough up the difference, because the cities were not supposed to sell no more than what your debtiness was.
It's like when you have tax sales, right? If a property is in tax sale for $2,000,
right,
the city auctions it off.
Right.
So as a bidder, I can say it's in tax sale for $2,000, but I'm willing to pay $10,000
right,
to get it.
Right.
And so if the person doesn't redeem the property and the person who, you know, the bidder gets it, that means I give the city $10,000.
And you get the property.
And I get the property. Now, the question is, when the city gets $10,000.
They owe the difference to the original property owner.
I don't think they give the original property owner an $8,000 check.
And, well,
that's something that the city uses to make money. I'm not sure. Do they give the property person an $8,000 check? I don't think so.
That is, back in the day, I haven't done tax sales in a long time, but back in the day, because what happened is a lot of the investors were one of the things that happened, investors were offering way over the fair market value of the property to scare off other investors. They would say the property could be worth $10,000, they would offer $50,000 for it, they would get it for $50,000, and then they would try to negotiate not having to pay the $50,000 after, so they ended that practice illegally. But the city, if you owe $10,000 and your property and the city sells it for $15,000, then the city can't keep the difference because that they can't keep more than what was owed. So at least I don't think that's new. Maybe it's something that I've missed, but it didn't happen that way on any of the deals that I had.
Okay, we're getting ready to go into the second hour. Henry, we're gonna hold you over so we won't put any pressure on you to come on quickly. We're getting ready to go into the second hour of the Frank M. Conaway Sr. at our show with co-host attorney Tehma Smith-Wilson, attorney Robert Bob DeShields, yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. We talked about a lot of things today. We talked about the loss of Tina and Jim Brown, the debt ceiling, other things that I'm sure is going to be coming up. So don't go anywhere. Don't touch that dial. We will be right back. We got some lines open. 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010.
And you can bet he barely makes a dollar. His mother goes to scrub the floors for me.